She was someone that was always full of energy, strong-minded, strong-willed.
She was pretty intimidating on the court.
Her work ethic was as great as anyone I've ever coached.
I think Carol didn't know anybody not as a friend.
Carol was always a daredevil.
She was a hoot. She was just a riot to be around and just really had a silly side.
When was Carol not having fun?
She was the kind of player that you couldn't do without her on the court. You know, you could do without some of the other people, but you couldn't do without Carol on the court because she brought those other intangible things that a lot of players don't bring.
On the court, she was that picture of what you saw on the outside of her, tough and in control of the situation, calm, collected, didn't matter what happened, she was there and she was there to play. She was going to take care of things on the court when she needed to.
I always loved to watch her be the one that get set up for the kills because she was the, you know, an outside hitter on the court. I mean, you know, you got six players out there and they're all playing really hard, but you could really tell she was, you know, really giving it her all every time she was out there.
People would follow her. Oh, she had leadership characteristics, and people don't follow everybody, but she. She was, again, she would say things as a leader, and she would follow through herself with those things that she would talk about.
I don't know if everybody saw her silly side, but there are several things that I can remember that just cracked me up about her little sayings, even her becoming the mascot. I don't know if people remember that she was the stag mascot, dressed up in the little corny the deer suit. I can remember her dressing up at Halloween one year as Coach Lowry. That's the kind of coach she was. We knew we could do that kind of thing with her, but Carol put baby powder in her hair to make it salt and peppery and wore the typical windsuit that Linda would always wear. She'd walk down the hall swishing her pants like Coach Lowry would with a whistle around her neck.
Carol was a camp counselor at Camp Lone Star for several years. She ended up teaching second grade in Hawaii. She really just enjoyed playing with the kids and would do the formal teaching, but I think she was more comfortable with more of the informalized nature of teaching. What really formulated her, hey, I really want to be a teacher, was her experiences at Camp Lone Star.
She was playing softball with a summer rec league and blew her knee out really bad and had to have surgery on it. So she came in that first year and considered not even coming to Concordia.
Carol came back, and it was a tough year for her because she was so competitive. She came back and she said, "You know, I don't know if I'm coming back." And I just looked at her and I said, "Carol, I said it's going to be an uphill battle with your knee, you know, but you can do this. You go home and you tell your mom and dad that you want to be a Lutheran school teacher. And by the way, you're going to play volleyball." While you're doing it, you're going to play volleyball.
And she convinced her to come, and once Carol got there, she became, from this quiet person that I met at tryouts, to this vibrant, involved in everything kind of person on campus. And if I remember correctly, she was a campus ambassador, and she was involved in the chapels, the Christian life. She got involved with everybody, knew everybody, was friends with volleyball players, basketball players, people in the seminary, just, you know, there were people from all realms of the groups of Concordia that she was friends with, and I think Concordia became a part of her.
She and I had said, well, hey, you know, hey, maybe we need to go do something special for our honeymoon. Or to celebrate our anniversary and all, and there was another couple there at the church that we attended that was also interested in doing something, you know, kind of exciting and kind of out there and all, so we all decided to go to New Zealand. That day on July 25, it was really cold, probably one of the coldest days I've ever experienced, and it's up in the mountains. We went on the rafting ride and ended up going through a tunnel that at the end of it had kind of two different directions to go down. Ended up steering instead of to the right, ended up going over the waterfall, and last thing Carol said to me was to hold on. The next thing I recall is I was sitting in the boat. I was the only person in the boat.
It was a very sad day, and word passed very quickly that had happened.
I got a phone call. It was late on a Tuesday night, and it was Mark Doobie on the phone. Mark Doobie and I never talked on the phone, and I wondered right away why he would have been calling me. And he broke the news to me that the accident had happened, and I can remember the feeling of just loss and shock. She was supposed to be the godmother of my second child. After her death, we ended up talking to Mark and asking him if it would be okay if she was our honorary godmother for our second child, so yeah.
For Carol, it was definitely all along ministry. She would have probably never said that because ministry to her was just, that was just who she was. So she didn't have to sit in there and think, okay, now I'm in ministry mode, now I'm in educator mode, now I'm in sports mode. That was just always coming out of her on the court, off the court, in the classroom, everywhere.
I think she's the epitome of what a Concordia athlete should be like. Strong Christian faith, but a tough, competitive athlete.
She's very deserving because she gave 5 years of her life doing what she loved for an institution that she loved.
I just miss her. I just miss her. I mean, there's no other way to describe it. If you ask that question of anybody else, that's what they would say. There's just no one way to pick apart any one thing of Carol. It was just, you just missed everything about her.